साथियों, माफ कीजिए, मैं अपनी बात अंग्रेजी में रखने वाला हूँ, लेकिन इसके पहले मैं हिंदी में ही इस किसान आंदोलन के सभी साथियों को सलाम करना चाहता हूँ और ख़ास करके उन किसानों को सलाम करना चाहता हूँ जो 2 महीने से दिल्ली के ठंड में बैठे हुए और देश के कोने कोने में शांति से धरना प्रदर्शन करते हुए संघर्ष कर रहे हैं। मेरे समझ में ये केवल 3 कानूनों को हटाने की संघर्ष नहीं है, ये किसानों की आज़ादी की लड़ाई है, ये मजदूर किसान एकता की लड़ाई है और लोकतंत्र बचाने की भी लड़ाई है। आपके संघर्ष से हमें बहुत प्रेरणा और उम्मीद मिली, इसके लिए धन्यवाद। नाउ आई स्विच टू इंग्लिश एंड लेट मी बिगिन विद अ फ्यू जनरल रिमार्क्स। द 3 farm laws दैट आर सॉट टू बी रिपील्ड and in particular the so-called APMC Bypass Act, are widely perceived as a form of liberalization and deregulation of agriculture. In my view, it would be more accurate to call them Agribusiness Promotion Acts, which is not exactly the same thing. But since deregulation is an important part of the story, let's start from there. Now, whenever the free market is being praised, we must remember a few things. First of all, we must remember that in many contexts, the free market, if such a thing exists, is a very defective institution. If you want a choice between 200 different types of cars, the market may serve you quite well. But if you want good public transport, or healthcare, or quality education, or a sound environment, or a fair justice system, or a functioning democracy, or almost anything that really matters for the quality of life, the free market will not take you very far. In all these fields, some form of public action, or at least regulation, is essential. And if you think of it, even when you buy and drive a car, you depend on public authorities in many ways, for instance, to ensure safety standards, pollution norms, traffic control, and of course, the availability of an ambulance if you have an accident. Secondly, in many circumstances, the free market has a kind of self-destruction property in the sense that it quickly leads to the concentration of power, and then this power is used to crush competition and undermine the market itself. This tendency is particularly strong in sectors where there are so-called economies of scale, which means that unit costs go down as the scale of production increases. This is because economies of scale give an advantage to large companies and the small ones get progressively eliminated. Today, some of the world's largest companies are reaping the benefits of global economies of scale and becoming richer and more powerful than ever before. In India itself, some companies like Reliance have become unimaginably rich and powerful by crushing competition, and of course also by looting the country's natural resources, plundering the public sector banks, and twisting public policy in their favor. We must be very suspicious of this corporate power and of the speed at which it can take over new sectors of the economy. And thirdly, we must remember that even the best functioning competitive market is no guarantee of social equity. The market has nothing to do with equity. It has to do with limited forms of efficiency, such as ensuring that there's a good supply of umbrellas during the monsoon and of quilts during the winter and not the other way around. It has nothing to do with ensuring that everyone has a quilt in the winter. In fact, just as the market often leads to the concentration of power, it also tends to create economic inequality. All this is relevant to agricultural marketing. A farmer who is trying to sell her produce after the harvest is in danger of becoming a sitting duck. She is often in a hurry to dispose of the produce and earn some cash with little information, limited facilities, and little bargaining power. That is why there is a rich history around the world of farmers trying to form or demand collective institutions that serve their interests and help them to get a better price for their produce in particular, whether they are cooperatives or unions or state corporations or other organizations. It is in this spirit, I believe, that APMCs, the Agricultural Produce Marketing Committees, were formed in India many years ago. A mandi is a natural way of facilitating regulation and collective action in agricultural marketing. If the APMC mandis have not done well, they must be reformed or supplemented with other well-regulated and accountable institutions, as some states have already tried to do in recent years. Replacing them with an unregulated market would be jumping from the frying pan into the fire. In fact, the regime that is sought to be put in place by the APMC Bypass Act is worse than an unregulated market. It is an oxymoronic regime of dual control, with the APMC mandis remaining under the control of state governments and the so-called trade area outside the APMC mandis coming under the control of the central government and presumably remaining largely unregulated. This dual control structure is problematic in many ways. It is an invasion of the constitutional responsibility of state governments for agricultural marketing. It undermines the APMCs by querying the pitch in favor of the trade area. It divides the farmers and deprives them of any control over marketing institutions. It makes it very difficult to hold traders accountable in the trade area. It creates a danger of rapid concentration of power in agricultural marketing as large companies take over the trade area. And last but not least, it threatens to turn the trade area into a battlefield between the central and state governments. In fact, the battle has already begun, with several states unilaterally passing bills aimed at overriding the APMC Bypass Act. All this has been well discussed in the background material that has been circulated in advance of this Kisan Sabha. To these dangers, I would add the danger of a misuse of regulatory powers in the trade area on the part of the central government. The general perception is that the trade area will remain unregulated, but that may or may not be the case. The APMC Bypass Act gives the central government sweeping powers to regulate the trade area and especially electronic trade. How these powers will be used is anyone's guess. Just to illustrate the danger, it is possible that the central government might use these powers one day to replace physical procurement of agricultural commodities with a national system of deficit payments. In the deficit payment system, there is no physical procurement, but the government pays farmers the difference between MSPs and market prices. This may never happen, but if it does, it is likely to be quite a mess. And also, it is likely to go hand in hand with an attempt to roll back the public distribution system, because the PDS depends on physical procurement. And if you think that the National Food Security Act is a protection against this, then please remember that the Act does not rule out the replacement of food rations with cash transfers. Now, this whole scenario is perhaps far-fetched, but it is just an illustration of how the central government's regulation powers under the APMC Bypass Act could be misused. None of this is to deny that there are serious issues of efficiency, equitability, and sustainability with the current regime of agricultural marketing. but the dual control framework that the APMC Bypass Act seeks to put in place is not the answer. It is poor economics, it fails to address the key issues, and reduces farmers' control on the marketing system. This act will help the central government to evade mandatory taxes in its procurement operations. It will help companies like Adani to take over some of the FCI's work. It will help Reliance to conquer the market for agricultural produce, but it is very unlikely to serve farmers' interests. Let me end here and once again express my support and admiration for the farmers who are braving the cold and the lathis and the slander to stand up to their demands, stand up for their demands. Their unity and solidarity is indeed inspiring, and it gives hope that there is still some life in Indian democracy. Jai Hind.